Okay, great. So yeah, I am Decebal, working in principle with machine learning and having a focus on artificial neural networks in general. And yeah, this works great. This is the outline of the talk, practically a bit of the motivations, why this is important, talking a bit about how the things were going into the past and a bit about sparse-to-sparse training, which is the main part of the talk today. Do you know this guy? Yeah, it's Sheldon, and it is a famous movie actor, but also character in the movie. And actually, we can also see it as a system. If we would like to understand Sheldon and what he does, what we can do, for instance, using the traditional reductionist paradigm, we'll try to zoom in on different components of a system and try to understand them. For instance, we can go on the brain side, we're trying to pull apart and try to look in the neurons, but also we can look to the skeletal system, to the muscle system. Even the computer is part of this system, for instance, and we try to understand what is happening. This actually works very nice, through millenniums of evolution. We are able to achieve what we have today with this paradigm. But actually, it also has a bit of a limitation. For instance, if you are someone on the left side and you like to reconstruct your system, you might have a bit of a problem. It's a bit more philosophical paradigm. Actually, I'm right here in Cyprus. This limitation was still by the ancient Greeks, actually, millennials ago. And then, in my research in general, I'm trying to have greater this approach of complex system, which I'm not sure how well it is defined, but the basic idea is perhaps, you look to all these subsystems, but also the interaction between them. And hopefully, if you are on the top right corner, you may be able to reconstruct the original system starting from there. And if you ask me how I really use this, not really use it in practice, but rather is my research per philosophy, how I'm trying to address the things in general. So coming back to something more concrete, this is my research in a nutshell. So trying to have this idea in my complex system, at the beginning of my PhD, when I started doing research, I was trying to use two approaches, network science and artificial intelligence, actually to answer to some real or open question from computer vision to communication networks and even smart grids. And while doing that, I end up having some scalability issues in some form or another, independently on the algorithm used. It was an algorithm from network science, AI, always reach some scalability issues. And somehow I transformed this into my main research question. And I say, okay, actually, instead of using separately network science or AI, why should not try to look at the synergy between them? We can try to look more into it and try to, take the best out of both worlds and try to improve algorithms each and there. And actually, I will not focus today on the A-link actually coming from AI to do things in natural science. I am happy to take more discussion about this offline, but I will focus in this talk on the B-link, where we use some network science principle in order to improve artificial intelligence. And you will see that the talk is actually built by a couple of planes, which sometimes intersect, sometimes not. But please feel free to put me questions at any moment in time. So currently, using this idea of the synergy between the two, I'm trying on one side to go back to the real world of open questions and to answer there a couple of questions, but also to look more theoretically into things like continual learning, reinforcement learning, sparse training theory, and so on, which is the main part of the talk today. So let's try to be all of us on the same page. So I am pretty sure that all of you know, but just to make sure, this is a typical representation of our artificial neural network. And what it has, it has some layers of neurons which are on top of the other. And here we take the information from the environment. This is the input, for instance. I can put some properties of this object here. And then the next one will process the information one on top of the other. So these hidden layers of neurons or the representation will transform this space into another space here. Every neuron from this layer is connected with all the neurons from the previous layer, and these are named connections or weights or optimizing parameters, how we want to do that. So if I input this here, the network will process the information and tell me the output or tell me whether this is a pointer or a mouse or a cup of tea, you know. And this is the basic idea of an LLM. And these type of models are pretty good actually, you know, to a single task. So you can input some type of data, some type of task, and then it will do pretty well. But if you want to learn a sequences of tasks, then they are not so good anymore. They come into problem. They are affected by things like catastrophic forgetting. So practically, you know, if I am at task number 10, it will most likely forget task number one if we don't do some particular things to input. Yeah, this is our neural network. So my research aim in medium term is actually to try to make these neural networks more scalable and more efficient, trying to make them to learn continuously and to generalize from limited data or multimodal data, different type of data put together. And there are a couple of things that we have. There are actually many things in order to be able to achieve this, you know, to a very to a good level. But today's talk will focus actually on the first challenge. We have too many connections in a neural network. And actually, it's more than this. Existing software and hardware is optimized just for dense neural networks. We will see further what that actually means. And this limits the representational power, efficiency, and so on. So why we want to make neural networks more efficient? I have a couple of examples here. On the left side, we have an image. An image we know pretty well to address it. It has, for instance, you know, height and weight. And for instance, if we can have over 1,000 pixels on over the on all parts, and this can lead to over 5 million dimension overall. And convolutional neural networks are pretty good to address this. But still, sometimes you have densely connected layers on top of the convolutional layers, and those can raise some scalability issues. Another example. We have biological data where we cannot really apply convolution because we don't have this spatial relation between data. We have tabular data practically, and there the typical approach is to use feature extraction or feature selection. And for this, we need expert knowledge to understand which are the most important features there. And it is a hard process to automatize easily. We can have low resource devices where, for instance, throwing an example for privacy issues, we want the network to be able to train directly on that low resource device. A phone is pretty powerful, but think that we can have also even more or less powerful things. And the typical approach is to, you know, put your data in the cloud, train their model, take the model, move it on the phone, you know, and then you can use it. And how we can actually alleviate this? And just going, you know, to the latest discussions about the large language models. Here is an example from the GPT-3, which is actually pretty old already. I heard that GPT-4 is out there. But let's talk about GPT-3. It has over 100 billion parameters, and would need over 300 GPU years to compute. And as far as I read on the internet, you know, it's a proprietary code, so we cannot see exactly what is inside. One would need over $4 million to train it. We are at university. We have no way to do that. And as far as heard from, you know, unofficial sources is that GPT-4 can go to tens of millions of euros, which is huge. And yeah, can we do better? Can we actually decrease this training cost? I don't know. We'll try to see if it may be possible in the future. So this is my main research question for today and in the medium term, how to make more efficient, more performant these neural networks in general. So just to give you another motivation, this is from a paper extracted from 2019, and this is the carbon footprint for a couple of things. The first one is about training a transformer, so the one about GPT-3, and using also a bit of neural architecture search. And this goes to 300 tons of CO2 emission. If you look to a car in average, you know, for one lifetime, it is about 50 tons. A human life in average for 1 year, it's about 5 tons. So this is huge, actually. I was talking a bit earlier with some colleagues about climate change and things like that. Even for this reason, we shall try to reduce the cost of training such large models. And it may be possible. So coming back to the problem itself, what is the problem? So you remember the neural network that I put earlier. Here is just zooming in on one of those two consecutive layers of neurons. So what happened here? We have two layers of hidden neurons. But for them,
The pilots for each neuron is connected to this collective virtual vector, HK minus one, and for this virtual vector HK. All the connections between these are collected into a matrix WK. So pretty simple. 4 by 3 recorded layer. And if you look to the matrix, for instance, that we can obtain after chain, we can get this value actually, or this value represents a value for each of the way. And this looks fine, acceptably fine. But what if we go further? What if we like to compute the values of this neuron? This equation here, what we have to do is to take each neuron, multiply it by this way, and add all of them together, apply here a nonlinear activation function on the tip. We can compute the value of that neuron. But now looking here to the red part, you know, and if you look to the values in the matrix, what we can see that we have something like 0.02 and 0.01, which are pretty small. If we added small values in this equation here, actually it doesn't help too much in the overall output of that particular neuron. And what we did up to this moment, actually we optimized those values, we tried to find them values, but we stored them, you know, in the memory, but they doesn't help too much because they are pretty small, and that's something close to zero to something else will still give you something else, broadly speaking. So people observe this for quite some time ago, actually, and they are trying to alleviate this. So they use this dense to sparse training paradigm, which started from the 90s, from the work of Jan LeCun. And the basic idea is was that to train a dense neural network, and after that, to identify those unimportant connections, let's say those close to zero, but can be a couple of criteria to do that, and to take them out. So let me to actually explain a bit more how it works. This is in principle the algorithm to do that. But let's go to the example. So this is called pruning or dense to sparse training, the typical approach. So after you train that network for a bit, what you can do? You can identify, let's say, the smallest values closer to zero. You can use magnitude here, and you can remove them. Simply replace them with zero, take them out, you know, and go back to this training process and continue it until you are satisfied by a particular trade-off between sparsity and accuracy. So what I understand by sparsity, the number of zero connection or connection which doesn't exist from the total amount of connection that we may have there. But this helps just for inference. It makes it faster, you know, smaller. It gives you a smaller network, but just for inference. And also empirically, this to be somehow bounded up in terms of performance by the original dense network performance that you have. And there are a couple of references. I cannot go through all of them, but I'm sharing the slide after that, so you can look over. And then going next, we observe this idea. Okay, but what about training? How can we make the training more efficient? Why shouldn't look also to that? And this is the next part of the talk where we discuss about this idea that we introduce sparse to sparse training and the principles about it. And the inspiration actually comes from network science. Something that Constantin Ilas was very aware of, actually, and I really like that. And what is the idea in network science? You can actually model many real-world networks like social or network or biological neural network, you know, through a graph at the end. You have the nodes, you have the connection between them, and you try to model that that network to see what is happening. And on the other side, we have artificial neural networks, which also have the network term into them, but yeah, they don't have so much of this relation from the real world networks that we can find near us. And actually what we can say, we can observe that real world networks, they are sparse, they are never dense, you know, they also evolve through time. They change, they are not fixed. You know, what about neural networks? Can we do something similar to them? This was the question here. And actually I can show that, you know, it can be done. So what we propose initially in a 2016 paper, we say, okay, this is called a restricted Boltzmann machine. It's a two-layer neural solution. Actually, I will not go too much into its details, but it can model data distribution actually. And it works in a similar manner with an autoencoder. So we need to clear your real world data and then it learns something. The representation. And For density estimation, Dirichlet Boltzmann machine, it was a pretty good tool. Actually, it helped also, you know, to the rebirth of deep learning in 2006 when Geoffrey Hinton and his co-authors, they actually changed such things and in an unsupervised manner separately. Then they put them together and they obtained a deep neural network, because before it was quite difficult to train many layers of neurons. So we say, okay, let's do density estimation with this thing, but let's not make it dense. Let's make it sparse. So how to sparsify this? This was our question. And then we know that real world networks have something called the scale free topology. What means that? Means that you have a couple of hubs, you know, somewhere in the network. So those hubs, they have many, many connections, while in the majority of the nodes, they have very few connections. And this follow a power distribution, this degree for such a network. And also we can have smaller topology. What means that? Means that if you look to that network, any nodes are connected with a small amount of steps. So if I am discussing now about me, not people here, because we already, it's obvious that we probably have a two link maximum, but someone else, let's say, you know, the president of the NSA, of NASA. Probably, you know, in 5 or 6 steps, I am pretty sure that I can be connected with that person. So this is the idea of small world. Everything is quite connected with everyone. But I mean, as far as I know, so they say, let's put this together. Let's train something better, you know. We can make a sparse model, which has this type of connectivity, having the two properties here. And that's what we can use a bit of data statistics in order to know where to put the hubs, the units which have more connection. And we use this type of model, we call it XBM, complex Boltzmann machine. And we use this to model data distribution, to model our data. It turned out to work pretty well, actually, closely on par with its dense counterpart, but it kind of had a problem. It was too much engineering. You know, we did it just for Boltzmann machine. We didn't try other type of neural network architecture. So it needed a lot of fine tuning in order to make it right and work nicely, but it was working. And still, you know, that idea was bothering my mind. Networks are not really fixed. They are changed through time. And then we propose a different concept. We say, okay, we can actually start from any type of sparse connectivity, but then we'll let the network to change over time, the connectivity, you know, to adapt to model our data, to adapt to its environment practically. And we call this adaptive sparse connectivity, and this idea of changing things over time. And for this, we practically propose an algorithm called sparse evolutionary training. It's pretty simple. I will not go into its details here. I would rather prefer to actually give you an example how it works. So the same typical layer that we had before, but now we start sparse. We use here Erdos training lambda connectivity, which is pretty random actually. And what we can do next, we can train, for instance, for a bit, you know, our model on all the data that we have. Let's say for one epoch, we see all the data and we train the data. And then we get out some values on the way, like 3 minus 2, minus 2, 0.1, and so on. But what we saw previously, that you know the closest values closer to zero, they doesn't affect too much the network performance. So simply we can turn to further, we can remove them, you know? And actually in the paper, we say that we can remove a percentage of the connections. And it was safe to be set to something like 20% of the existing connection. It was pretty okay, trying to find the general value. So we remove these two connections, minus 1.5, 0.1, and then we get this type of static network, a sparse network. But we actually want to find the optimal connectivity here. So at the next step, we can simply add randomly two new connections, like the green one here, in different places. And then we continue this iteration, this training process, you know, and next time we can actually find another two connections, which are pretty small, the gray one here, and we remove them. And in this way, at the end, we combine actually the typical back propagation used for to train the weights of a neural network with this connectivity optimization problem. And we can find both a
quite good connectivity at the end, but also good values for the weights. And this is all. This is how it works. Very simple. And what it can do at the end, because I mentioned that we like to model data distribution. So this example here is on the same restricted Boltzmann machine that performs density estimation that I mentioned earlier.
And we use for the NMD region data set, the one there on the top, you see 0, 1, 2, and so on. And you see that you have a lot of information in the middle, or in the white region, while you have black area where there is no information there. This row represents restricted Boltzmann machine with 500 hidden neurons. Let's focus on this. So we have a 28 by 28 input pixel, because this is 28 by 28. So actually, this is our input layer in the network. And here, what we can observe that we start from heterogeneous random graph. So the heat map here tell us how many connections per input neuron or pixel we have. And we can see that we have around 10 connections, more or less, per neuron. This is at the beginning when we initialize it. And after that, after 150 inputs of training, what we can observe that this approach start to put more connections somewhere in the middle. So here in the middle, we have like 30 connections, while towards the end, we have towards zero connection, you know? So actually we learn where to focus our connection during training. And after 5,000 inputs, for instance, we can see that we have many connections in the middle, but we have very little or zero practically. And this is a similar example, but actually just for a larger restricted Boltzmann machine. So our model was able to somehow find patterns into the data automatically. But that's nice, but you can ask me what about accuracy, how it performs, you know, if I want to do a typical classification test. So this is an example on the CIFAR-10 data set. We use here a multi-layer perceptron, actually the model that I showed to you at the beginning of the presentation. And it's a 10 class classification problem. So we want to classify chicken, cars, and so on. And on the x-axis, we have the number of training epochs on the left plot. And on the y-axis, we actually have the accuracy in percentage. We want to be as higher as possible. And we compare a fully connected MLP, the blue one, together with an MLP, which has a static connectivity. So we start with something randomly sparse. And we keep it like this, the yellow one. And with our set MLP model, which evolves connectivity in time. And what you can observe actually, that our set MLP model can learn better and performs better than the fully connected model in time. And it actually was able to have some better generalization power than the dense model, even if initially you see that it runs a bit slower. Something interesting here on the second y-axis, we try to see what happens with the degree distribution of the hidden neuron. And this tells us how it came closer to a scale free distribution in training. So we start from something like a random graph, which is not, doesn't have a scale free distribution. And this shows this plot here, you know, that okay, initially it was something, it was not scale free, but actually during training, the degree distribution of the hidden neurons starts to be more like a scale distribution, which is something pretty interesting. But we didn't manage to do more than this, but it's still an interesting observation. What we enforced before, now it became naturally without enforcing it at all. So this is an interesting thing. But what is very interesting is also actually here, the number of parameters in the network. This is a fully connected layer, which have over 20 million parameters. And these are the sparse model, which have about 200,000 parameters. So 100 times fewer parameters, but actually better performance, just to summarize this. And this is a bit of an intermezzo moment, actually, just to give me some time. And we presented this idea of sparse evolutionary training at Digica in 2019. We had quite a full audience there. And somehow this kind of put a moment of this emerging field of sparse training or dynamic sparse training, how some people are calling it, or sparse to sparse training. And then each guy came, which was great for doing research, but not so much for, COVID, great for research, but not so much for interacting with people.
And now I'm actually happy that, you know, we start meeting again in person. This is from a tutorial that we gave at ECML PKDD last year. So I am very happy about this. And thank you very much again for inviting me. So what is further? A couple of examples of how we can use the idea of sparse training in several areas. So the first thing is about computer vision. We did our initial work just on fully connected layers and also on CNNs, but just replacing some fully connected layers on top. We didn't touch the convolutional layer themselves. And then this was not hard to crack, actually. And it was this paper from Tim Benoit, Luxet Mayer, where they actually say, okay, that random addition that I mentioned to you to explore the surface space, we can actually use something like momentum in order to explore better and also to address convolutional layers themselves. It turned out to be decently well, but then it was this paper from FG et al. From Google, where they actually say momentum is still hard to compute. So it's better just to look to the gradients of the non-existing connection just for a bit, you know, before to change the topology. And then it will be sufficient to give us some guidance, some hint where to go further, you know, where to add those new connections. So I think now there are two main approaches to add connections in sparse training. One is random and the other one is using this idea of the gradients. And also we continue their work and we try to see up to when we can do this training, you know, what can we take out of it? And we introduce this idea of in time over parameterization, saying that, you know, you need to look sufficiently over all possible connection, at least a particular moment in time, in order to have quite a decent performance overall, particularly in the case of convolutional layers, which are pretty more difficult. And here it's an example on ImageNet using ResNet 50. We sparsify the kernels. And on top, you have the dense accuracy. For on the left side sparsity 0.9, on the right side sparsity 0.8. And if you look here, for instance, at 0.9, you can see that using the algorithm from the paper that I mentioned earlier, we took this idea of exploring for quite some time, we can get pretty close to the dense performance. I mentioned that, like, for convolutional layers, it's a bit more difficult to get over the dense performance. But for instance, if we chain it a bit longer, but a bit lower sparsity level, actually we can get on par with this network performance. Still in terms of flops, actually we can be a bit faster, but there is this problem of that many of the research on sparsity simulate sparsity using binary mask because the hardware and software libraries like PyTorch, TensorFlow, they are not really optimized for sparse matrix operations. So then we found these values theoretically, but not really, we cannot show good speed up in practice, until now at least. And also we take this idea, okay, we have sparse training, but we can actually obtain different networks during the course of a training. So why not trying an ensemble, you know? Ensemble are pretty difficult to compute, they become large, but not to try ensemble methods, you know, to do some computer vision stuff. And the same idea of ResNet 50 on ImageNet. What we did here actually, during we call this method EDSD, efficient dynamic sparse training. And the idea is that during this training process, what we can do from time to time, we change a bit more the topology. So if I mentioned that, let's say we remove 20% of the weights and during this evolution, actually, let's say at a particular moment in time, we can remove 80% of those existing waves. You know, we obtain a completely different sparse network. And each of these points can represent our ensemble members. And at the end, we just use typical ensemble stuff. The other approach, this was the DSC ensemble. The other one was actually to train a couple of sparse networks from scratch, you know, differently, starting from a different random seed, train it a few times. And this actually turned out to be much better in terms of performance. So while this is the FD ensemble, which still has one run overall, it can get on par with the dense ensemble performance, not the single model, in terms of accuracy. The DST ensemble, where we train a couple of sparse network from the beginning to end, it can get pretty good in terms of accuracy overall, going over the dense ensemble performance. Yeah. This is an example on computer vision. I would like to give an example about tabular data now, which I find it pretty appealing, but it's not so much working to that. And I mentioned that it's hard to actually use sparsity Fourier. But here we actually prototype a case where it is possible to do it. So we implemented everything from scratch in pure Python using SciPy matrix operation, sparse matrix operation. Of course, it works just for an MLP actually, but we show that it is possible to do it. So we are, for instance, we are able to train 1 million neuron on a typical laptop without even having any GPU support. We cannot use it anyway, because it doesn't support us. But, and we did this on some biological data, very high dimensional biological data, like for instance, leukemia dataset, over 50,000 features, 2000 samples. And the typical approach here is to perform feature selection and extraction plus a classifier. So select your most important features out of those 50,000 and then use a classifier to do classification. And we compare our approach where we put directly all the data because it's sparse, so it was really sparse. And then we were able to accommodate all that large amount of features. And here it's like a decent small set NLP. I don't recall exactly the number. This is the large one, the one with 1 million neurons. We just tried to see how it worked out. And then it turned out that, you know, this is pretty sparse. This is delivered with a very, very good connection. For instance, total training time plus fading is 65 seconds for this model. And it reached about 82.8% accuracy on the leukemia dataset. But then the method that we compare with, the typical one, was using an ensemble of classifiers and support vector machine on top of it. Even when the user had a cluster, actually, they need over 300 seconds to learn to work with the same type of data, and at the end it reaches a bit lower accuracy. So this somehow highlights the advantages of using sparsity, you know, and why we need to put more focus into this, because we can do much things much better and much faster. Another example is to do this feature selection. I already showed you this idea of automatically pattern discovery. So we observe that these input neurons, they start to model our data distribution. So we use here an autoencoder, the typical one. We initialize it in a sparse manner, and here the blue circles tell us how important is the particular input neurons. And we use something called neuron strength, you know, the neuron strength in graph theory actually, to tell us sum over the absolute values of the weights for that particular neuron, to tell us how important is that particular input neuron. And initially, there it is the same thing. But actually, after some training, we can observe that some of them, they become pretty large. So actually, the strength of that particular input neuron is pretty high. So this tells us that is an important feature. But at the end, we just get the values for this strength for all the input neurons, you know, and we sort them. And we, if we want to pick the most important two features, we just pick this two, I think, because these are the highest. Or if we want three, we'll pick this one and this one. So it's pretty simple how it works. And we use this idea for feature selection. We compare it on a couple of direction, like clustering accuracy, classification accuracy, running time, memory, with some typical approaches for feature selection, but also with, I would say this is the direct competitor of this complete autoencoder, which are using also an autoencoder, a dense one, to perform feature selection. And it turned out, here this source tells us fire is better actually, you know. And if we look actually in our model quick selection, QS, how we call it, it performed pretty well in terms of all these you know, dimensions in comparison with the other methods. It can be pretty fast, it can be quite accurate, and so on. But what is more interesting even than this is that we tried again this idea of implementing it in a truly sparse manner. So here we have an artificial data set. We have many lines. I will just focus on two. Don't worry. Number of features. So we just increase the number of features up to 40,000 on an artificial data. And here we have the running time seconds actually. And if you focus here, this is a case for our quick selection, our proposed method, which runs on a typical CPU. And you know, we compare it with its equivalent, the complete autoencoder. We can see that this, even if it runs on GPU, it actually needs much more training time than our model, which runs on CPU, because it's normal. If you have a contracting number of parameters with respect to the number of neurons, it simply takes more.
And actually, you can see this quadratic relation here, where we have more and more hidden neurons, like this end here, by the teras. So if you have more and more hidden neurons, this quadratic relation, you can observe it very, very easily. Well, our quick selection actually for 10,000 neurons is this green line here. It's still linear with respect to the number of input features. So this is the advantage, like if you go larger. Another example is the continual learning. You know, up to now we see that, you know, we can have pretty good sparse network, which can perform pretty well on single task. But why not to split, you know, if we have such a large architecture, we can use a subnetwork to perform a task like the red one. And we can use another subnetwork, which can have some overlapping neurons, which is the red one, the blue one here, to learn a second task, and so on. And this has turned out to be pretty okay. We applied that on computer vision stuff, on CPAR 10, on 100. We split the data in 6 tasks. This is after learning. And the blue model space that we proposed, it seems to be pretty robust actually. So you see, after even learning the old task, it still performs decently well on the task number one. And I think if I look, probably the second best performer is EVFC, elastic wave consolidation, which performs pretty well on all of them. But if I look, for instance, to the red one, which is a night classifier, you know, just training it on the task number one, then on task number two, but without considering this idea that I will forget what happens before, without considering the idea of catastrophic forgetting, it performs perfectly well at the end, but doesn't do anything on the other one. That was pretty nice. Actually, how it works, I have a plot here, which I think explains it a bit better and different. And if I am not able to explain it well, please ask Constantine, because he's a co-author of this paper, how it actually works. You know, assuming that I have a particular task here, I have some couple of stable units, which knows how to perform on my previous one task. And then I want to explore my space, you know, to see how can I learn task number T minus one? So I can actually look to all the candidates, all the units of the neurons that I didn't use up analysis, orange one here. And then I can do this idea of, you know, removing an important connection, growing connection in order to explore all the possible space. And at the end, I will simply add to my set of stable tasks here, this blue one, the new ones that I learned for the task T minus one. And that's the new connection here, you know, the recent problem. And when I learn this task, these connections, this new one here, I'm closing them. So I go further to learn task T, and I'm just looking to the space where I can add still new connections, because the others already learned pretty well what was happening. The same idea, what happens after learning. The NISFA method, comparing with typical traditional approaches like this EWC, which was also pretty good before, you know, it can perform decently better all the time, even when we have a very large amount of tasks, like 20 tasks and so on. So this gives us to the last example that I want to give it for the federated learning. I mentioned that low resource devices is kind of important problem. Sometimes we want to learn, be able to learn directly on low resource devices, or to use this idea of federated learning, what it does. We have, for instance, a server, and then we have a number of clients. But what we can do, we have our data on the client. We have some model here, some general model. We send that model to the clients. They learn from each client on the particular data that each client has, you know, and then we send them back together to the server. We have a for these a bit different models now, and at the end, we do and we do this loop, you know, going back to the server aggregate, send them to the clients to learn more data and so on. Somehow this sounds can fit nicely with sparse network. And it was this paper from Hanju Zhu et al. They use idea of sparse training here, and they compare fully connected models with sparsely connected models. And it turned out that in terms of performance, this was pretty decently, but it was a problem. They were not really able to put together these different models because they are sparse. And you remember that the process changed the topology, and actually when you add a connection, you change it a bit and so on. So kind of they renounced of adding new connections, they were just removing. And because they didn't find a good way to maps of topologies together. But it performs pretty well. And actually, there are more recent papers where the whole process of adding and removing connections on clients turn out to be manageable, and we can find an optimal topology there. Why that? Why better generalization? These are just hypotheses, actually. I have no idea. And I invite you to think together to it. In this paper from FG et al., they actually show that if you have your space of solution practically, if you do pruning or the typical hypothesis, you end up in some region at the end after the training process. So somewhere here, let's say. But if you do this training from scratch, training smart network DNP, you may end up in a completely different ballgame. It's not the same. And they showed this in this paper. And then if I corroborate this with something that we show in a paper of us, we try to see how different can be this sparse neural network. How many good topologies we have, because if it is one and you have to search for it a lot, then it doesn't make sense. But if there are many which are good enough, then actually it's different. What we have here is this heat map, we have 10 networks. The heat map tell us how different they are. And means that they are pretty similar. One seems that they are quite different. And we have these 10 networks, which are very, very similar. It's like 0.1, 0.2, so all of them are quite close to each other. But during training, and we propose actually a method to measure the distance between two topologies, because it was not there. During training, what we can observe is that the distance, because we train again using a different random seed, the distance between the network starts to be higher, so it goes to 0.5 after some training, and actually at the end of the training, they are very different. The black one is just because the distance to itself, but to all the other networks is very far, like 0.8, 0.7. So we obtain 10 networks applying the process. But obviously, if we look to the performance in terms of accuracy, all these 10 networks on two data sets, they perform very, very, very similar. So they are very, very different in terms of topology, but they perform the same. So actually, this tells us that, and we have many more experiments in the paper, tell us that, there are many ways to solve this problem. So you don't have to search for the optimal solution, but a good one, and you will find it pretty easy. And we say that if there are 10 of these, probably these are very different. We have many, many buttons for this sparse solution. So actually, that's why I think it's easy to go better, to have better generalization in general. The challenges, I mentioned them before. It's hardware, software is optimized in general for dense matrices. And also, you don't really understand why sparse training works and why works so better, at least in some cases. And I think the situation is changing. I took this slide from Jeff Poole from NVIDIA. And on the x-axis, we have the years and number of papers about publications about pruning. And we see that in the before 2000, it is a kind of pipe, this goes up. People are starting to be interested more in sparse network and what they can bring. And also, I would like to mention that, the previous latest NVIDIA GPU A100 support 2-to-4 sparsity. It's still a very hard constraint. 2 out of 4 connection can miss, but still gives you 50% speed up in hardware. So, I think that slowly the things are moving towards having better support for sparsity. If you'd like to know more, actually, I didn't talk today about deep reinforcement learning, but will be another talk here in 1 week from now, talking about sparsity and deep reinforcement learning. And you may want to see it. And also, we have this series of sparsity in our neural network workshops, which was already like the third edition this year. And you can find many talks and things on YouTube about it. So this is the link. And I will be happy to take discussions further offline about all this. This is just some references, trying to group them per categories. And I will share the slides, so I don't really want to go much into them. And these are some examples of open source code in general for all our papers. You can find the link to that particular particular code that has been used in that paper, but also some links from the community which is working on sparse neural network in general. And I think they are pretty good. And in the future, I really believe that using sparse network, we can have
better performant, more performant networks, which can be much more efficient. We can really reduce energy consumption and CO2 in general. And also, but we need to work more to get a better understanding of what is happening, to be able to to get the full benefits of sparsity in practice. And yeah, it's actually a lot of work, and these are difficult challenges. But yeah, I'm looking with confidence to the future, to be honest. And this is actually my slide. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm happy to take questions. I really would like to thank to all my collaborators, teachers, mentors across time, and also to the PhD students, because without them, I wouldn't be here today. So I am really appreciative to all these people. And thank you very much for your attention. I'm happy to take questions.